my plea.
Just a dose of love.
Daily walking close to thee. Let it be.
Phyllis would say it's a typical mountain weather today, isn't it? Freezing. Where's that Shane Coffs? He probably brings some of that Brooklana down with him. Oh. I'd like to welcome you here this afternoon as we've gathered to give thanks, to honour, to remember and say our loving goodbye to Phyllis Ivy Renison. Loved wife of Jack deceased and Hilton deceased. Cherished mother and mother-in-law of Gary and Heesun. Brian deceased. Rob and Helen. Lynn and Ian. And Peter and Chris, a proud Nana Freak to her grandchildren and great-grandchildren, step-mum to Shirley, Julie and Ron, and obviously a dear friend to many. It's a great honour and privilege for me to be here and to officiate at Phyllis's funeral service, as she was such a well-loved and respected lady. I know today is a sad day, but I hope at the end of this farewell and celebration for Phyllis that you feel glad that you took the opportunity to grieve with others in the presence of others who have known and loved Phyllis, either through her passion for life, through her hard work, her kindness and her gentleness. So there is so much to remember and so much to be thankful for Phyllis in the way she shared her life with those around her. We're going to share some of the good and happy moments of her life, and I'd like to call upon Shane and Claudia to come up and share a few words.
Phyllis Ivory Renison was born August the 7th, 1926, to Kenneth and Ivory Matheson in a suburb called East Kew in Melbourne. We know her as Mum, Nan or Nan Freak. Not long after Nan was born, what was called the Great Depression happened, and her father lost his fibrous plaster business and their home. Because there was no work, they had to move in with Nan's grandparents. In 1927, Nan's younger sister Betty was born. In 1935, they packed up and moved to Wagga Wagga and began a new life. The year Nan finished high school, the war broke out. Soldiers would often go to church where Nan and family attended, and people would often invite them back to their homes for lunch. And Nan's family did the same. One particular time, two soldiers came to church, and Nan described them as one was a very tall and the other not so tall. They went for a number of weeks, then the tall one was posted somewhere else. The not so tall one started going quite regularly, and when he had weekend leave, her mum and dad asked him to stay with them on Saturday nights. Of course, this not so tall man was John Alfred Cecil Freak. everyone called him Jack. Jack and Phyllis were married on March the 9th, 1946, and spent their honeymoon at Katoomba. Not long after, he was discharged from the army, and they packed up their belongings and moved to Glen Innes, where Jack was from. Jack, known to me as Pop. Pop got a job he had before he joined up in the crockery department of a department store. And in February 1947, their first son, Gary, was born, and 22 months later, Brian was born in December 1948. Brian started to become very ill when he was about 3 months old, and they decided to move back to Wagga. Robert was born in April 1950. As Brian's health worsened, they moved to Melbourne, where he was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis. Pop's sister, Maisie, found a house at Sawtell and worked for Pop. So just after Robert's second birthday, they moved to Sawtell. A few months later, moved into the Coffs Harbour house to house sit for a couple. Sadly, whilst living there, Brian passed away at the age of 5. Sometime later, Nan and Pop purchased their own home in Victoria Street. In February 1956, their daughter Lynn, my mum, arrived, and then in November 1957, Peter was born. When Lynn and Peter went to school, Nan was active on the preschool committee as treasurer for a year and then president for a couple of years. When Peter started infant school, Nan helped in the school canteen until he went to high school. Pop and Dad had a grocery store down the jetty, and Nan worked with them whilst the children were at school. They later sold it, and Pop started working at the Coffs Harbour Base Hospital as a carpenter. Nan then got a job as a cleaner at the Jetty High School, where she worked for several years before going to work as a cleaner at the newly built Arara High School. Nan not only worked whilst raising her children, she nursed Pop's dad, who lived with them for quite some time, until his passing. Several years later, Pop's brother Alan, who lived in Sydney, became ill and unable to care for himself. So he moved in with Nan and Pop, where Nan cared for him until his passing. Meanwhile, Nan's children had all grown up, married, and had children of their own. Nan would go to work early each morning to clean, and then when she came home, she looked after us while our parents, or mine at least, worked. Years later, Pop was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, and they joined the Parkinson's support group, which at this stage was just trying to get started in town. Nan became a very active member and was treasurer for quite some time. Pop passed away in 1995, and Nan retired from the Parkinson's support group a few years later and received a certificate from the head office in Sydney for her services. Nan spent a few years on her own after Pop passed, sold the family home, lived in a few units, then moved in with Mum and Ian for 10 years. An old friend who went to Sunday school and church when Nan was at school in Wagga got in contact with Nan. His name was Hilton Renison and lived in Nerang, Queensland. Hilton would come down quite often to visit Nan and then asked Nan to marry him. They were married on the 13th of November 2010 at the ripe old age of 84 and 86. Mum never thought she would be arranging her own mother's wedding. Nan and Hilton lived in Hilton's home in Nerang. They spent a happy and loving 9.5 years together until Hilton became ill and went into a nursing home. At the end of July 2019, Nan also became unwell and moved back in to live with Mum and Ian, who were living in Brooklana, so Mum could care for her. Hilton sadly passed away in 2020. Mum and Ian moved back to Coffs at the beginning of 21. As travelling up and down the mountain was getting too much for Nan. Nan remained at home with Mum and Ian until the 18th of June, when she peacefully passed away. Nan was truly the most caring and loving mother of 5, grandmother of 12, great-grandmother of 20 and a bump, and a step-grandmother of 4, and the matriarch of this family. Be very sadly missed.
Thank you, Shane. You've done a great job, mate. Very brave to get up and do that. And you spoke about the Parkinson's as well. There's a donation box outside if people would like to give to that. We'd appreciate that as well. I'd like to call upon now Lily, Kylie and Cass, or are you going to come up on your own, Lily? No, you'll come up together, that's all right then. So Kylie and Cass as well.
Nan, your life was full of loving deeds, forever thoughtful of our special needs. Today and tomorrow, my whole life through, I will always love and cherish you.
Firstly, I'm Kylie, the oldest grandchild on the freak side. I would like to thank everybody for attending and celebrating our lovely and gorgeous Nana and Grandma to so many. Nana adored all her children and grandchildren so much. We all knew that. We would only have to go over to Nan and Pop's for Christmas or somebody's birthday. And with such a large family, these were always the best of times. Nan just loved doing things for anybody, really. You could just tell. She taught me to knit on the tiniest knitting needles and play the organ. The saints go marching in. I thought this was so good. Nans and Pops teach us things we don't realise until later in life, and these you hold dear and hopefully pass on to our own children. For me, I spent most of the time just talking and listening to Nan's stories, especially lately. But my favourites when she would let us win Chinese checkers. She already had one, and she let me and Brett win. And we just laugh. She was the champion, for sure. Nan loved doing her puzzles and knew where each piece would go. I'm sure I made her frustrated at times. Some days, we just mostly sit in the sun. Us girls would have a wine or two, and mostly we'd remember Nan's cuppa, but that was Cass's fault, if she forgot. But however, Nan loved everyone around, whoever popped in. You could just tell she was happy and loved Nana and Grandma. We loved her. And we sure made sure she always knew. Today, we say our goodbyes with lots of tears, but that's okay too. And Nan will always be with all of us. I love you, Nan. Lastly, I would like to say a really big thank you to my auntie Lynn, from my Nan. She was so grateful for each and every day. She loved you. And then through Nan. I love you.
The old saying, life is short, really didn't apply to Nan. To be honest, she was starting to get my hopes up that she was immortal. When Nan got sick last time, she said to me that she didn't think she'd be around much longer, that she'd like to stay for a little bit more, but that she'd probably been around long enough. As she lay there, I bawled and hugged her and told her I still needed her. She told me she knew, but that I had a lot of people around me who loved me, and that we had some wonderful memories. Then she said, I told them they were hens. You see, I have been very privileged to have spent a lot of time with Nan. and she was trying to distract me by reminiscing. My mum and dad built our family home at the back of Nan and Pop's place, and while Nan lived there, we had no fence between us. Mum and Dad had also bought John and Jess a guaranteed hen each. These hens spent their days traumatising us children by attacking us whenever we went out to the yard. In order to get to Nan's, you had to run the gauntlet. I regularly frequented Nan's and bore the scars of my heroism for years after. The mental scars have never faded. Birds are definitely not one of my favourite animals. I reminded her of school holidays spent at her house with the cousins, and that she used to make us sandwich platters with banana and sugar sandwiches and fairy bread. She said, "Did I? How very domestic of me." My list of fond memories could go on forever, and I know we all have them. And I look forward to sharing them all with you later this afternoon. At the time of this particular conversation with Nan, I was staying with my cousin Kylie, and Nan told me that if I wanted to live as long as she did, that I needed to stay away from alcohol. Not that the two circumstances had anything to do with one another. She told me of when she was little and how she'd been part of a church group of women and children who were very against alcohol. Nan had definitely been around a long time and developed a wisdom and resilience that I aspire to. Kylie and I have been very lucky to have spent quite a bit of time together with Nan over the last year or so, sitting outside together in the sunshine drinking tea, when I remembered, or wine was one of my favourite things. Just sitting with Nan and discussing life was one of my favourite things. And she was right. We all have a lot of people around us that love us very much. Pablo Picasso once said that the meaning of life is to find your gift. The purpose of life is to give it away. Nan's gift was creating strong family values that have been instilled in every one of us. We rally together when times are tough, and we revel in the good times. No matter the distance or time that has passed, we always know we have one another. She had found her purpose, and in doing that, she's ensured that not only will she live on in every one of us, but also that we will all be okay. At the end of our conversation, Nan said, "Cassie, I love you very much, but I think I'd like to rest now." So I'm channeling Nan's strength and resilience in the comfort of knowing that when I look around the room, she still lives within us. She'll be dearly missed and cherished for so long as we live, but she will live on with the values that she's instilled with us and that we can continue to pass down to each new generation. In Nan's words, "Love you all. I'll let you rest now, Nan. Thank you for loving and shaping me."
Thank you, Lily, Kylie and Cass, for sharing those beautiful words from your heart. Family friends, I'm going to ask you to look up to the screen now. We've got some photos of Phyllis and all the family and friends, and some beautiful music that's been put and chosen as well.
You raise me up. I took the supermarket flyers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Packed up the photo album Matthew had made. Memories of a life that's been loved. Took the Garrett Wilson cars and stuffed animals. Pour the old ginger beer down the sink. Dad always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But Mom, there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up. But I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. When God takes you back, he'll say hallelujah, you're home. Fluffed the pillows, made the bed, stacked the chairs up. Folded your nightgowns neatly in a case. John said he'd drive, then put his hand on my cheek and wiped a tear from the side of my face. Now I hope that I see the world as you did, 'cause I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. When God takes you back, you'll say hallelujah, you're home.
My
Thank you for sharing them with us. You've done well to cut them down to 125 or so. Over 90 years of living. That's amazing. All right. I'd like to ask now Jess to come up and share a poem with us. Thanks, Jess.
The thing about Nan is that in some incredible way, despite how many children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, friends and family she had, she somehow had this ability to make every one of us feel a little extra special, a little extra loved. It might have been a special memory, a gift, piece of advice, a game, a puzzle, perhaps a special recipe. For me, one of these things was that she called me her butterfly. On almost every birthday card she wrote to my butterfly. And when I was little, she would greet me with it too. I don't know why I was privileged to have been given this special name, but I do know that every time it was used, I felt $1 million. And I'm pretty sure she knew that. I found a quote that said, "A butterfly lights us like a sunbeam, and for a brief moment its glory and beauty belong to our world, but then it flies on again. And although we wish it could have stayed, we are so thankful to have seen it at all." Well, Nan stuck around for more than just a fleeting moment. Though I guess in time it may seem that way. But my word, is it true that we are so lucky, and I feel so grateful to have had her as such a special part of my life for as long as we could. Every time I see a butterfly, I will remember her, and perhaps you might think of her also when one catches your eye. For Nan. Upon Nan's direct request, I'm keeping this quite brief, a little something only to honour both love and grief. A tiny little gesture for a mighty, merciful mother, a song of poetry for a beloved, brave grandmother. To a great grandmother with a family still sprouting, to our matriarch, 5 children, 12 grandchildren, 21 grandchildren, but who's counting? We will treasure every checkers game, every puzzle piece completed, every piece of meat pie we had the pleasure of eating, every giggle shared and every story told, every cuddle given with your hands so kind though cold. Nan, we will treasure every butterfly that graces us through day, and thank God every moment for the time that you could stay.
Jess, that was beautiful. Yeah, I'd like to ask Ron to come up, please. Thanks, Ron.
Hello, folks. For those that don't know me, my name's Ron Renison, and I'm Hilton's son, and obviously that makes me makes Phil my stepmum, a name I use with great affection. Also here is my wife Julie, my 2 daughters, Amy and Amanda, and my 2 sisters, Shirley and Julie. It was a sad phone call that I received from Lynn telling me of the passing of Phil. I know her as Phil. That's what Treasures is to me, and I know you as Mum and Nan for all you people. We had built a close friendship over the years following her marriage to Hilton, my dad, in November 2010. They had many years of happiness together, and we're all really grateful and thankful for that. I know they often said that they were fortunate to be able to spend so much time together. They were very much in love, and without that partnership, I know Dad would not have enjoyed life or even lived as long as he did. So it's with a very thankful heart that we think of Phil for her love and dedication to our dad. And just hearing the history of what people have been saying, it's a wonderful trait that she has, and accepting people into her life. And she had a whole family that you have never met up in Queensland, the church and friends and our family as well, all treasured her friendship. In that regard, a number of people do want to pass on their condolences. The Southport Church of Christ crowd, which is one big family, they spent a lot of time there where Phil and Dad shared their belief in God with a lot of other people. The Caspos, the Casperson family, which is our relatives in Australia and New Zealand. New Zealand contingent is Graham and Wendy Casperson. My cousin Doug Patterson, now, I mentioned him, he lives in Caloundra and he's on his own. But Phil used to ask about him quite regularly because she was concerned that he was on his own and just making sure he's all right. So it sort of challenged me to make sure I was in contact with him, ring him regularly, and we spoke recently and he wanted me to pass on his condolences as well. Again, that's typically Phil. She was a tough lady, and tougher than I really thought by the history that I've heard today. And she'd been through a lot in her life. But no complaining, or if she did, you try to talk about it, it is what it is, and we'd have to move on. And we saw her love for her sewing, which we all have benefited of, and she had a good sense of humour. We often laughed over me having to lift her into our Jeep, which is about her head height. I had to lift her body into the Jeep with her talking to her legs, saying, "Get in there." And getting out was easy. She just slid off the seat and I'd have to catch her. So we have great fond memories over the last 10, 12 years, 11 years. And it's thank you very much for the privilege of being able to talk and get to know you afterwards. So thank you very much for that. So in closing, I'd just like to say that Phil, Mum, Nan, will be greatly missed by all of us as well, from down south and up north as well. So she was much loved and will be greatly missed. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron, for sharing. I'd like to ask now Pete. Where's Pete? Over there.
You're our champion, mate.
Thanks, Cass.
You can have them back, mate.
Well, for a start, I'd just like to say what a great turnout. It blows me away that so many people want to be here with us today. And I thank each and every one of you for making time to come here and share this moment with us. Now, the digital world is with us and there's a live stream going for those people who are unfortunate enough not to be able to be here through different circumstance. And I'd just like to recognise a few of those. There's Gab's wife, Nerissa, all the way over in America. She'll be watching. There's Gary's wife, Heesun, his son, Brett, his daughter, Julie, and his extended family in Canberra. Down in Melbourne, we've got Mum's cousins, Gwenda and her sister Joy. And in Sydney, we have a niece of Mum's and a nephew, Ross and Lorraine. Ross actually had his plane booked and his accommodation booked, but that silly little thing called COVID was a bit too much for him to make it up here today. He thought it'd be best if he stayed home. So what I'd like to do is, on behalf of Gary, Rod and myself, we just want to say a very big thank you to Lynn and Ian for looking after our mum. They took a huge burden off our shoulders, put their lives on hold, well, for a long time, but especially over the last two or three years. So we want to publicly acknowledge and thank both Ian and Lynn. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jess's poem, you might have heard that she mentioned that Nan didn't like waffle. She didn't like what Lynn calls rattling on. So I'll try and keep this brief. The family home in Victoria Street, that was the only family home we had, had an eat-in kitchen, and there was a kitchen table there where we had every meal. And every meal, Mum had put a tablecloth on that table and all the rest of it. In that house, we also had a large lounge room. Now, that lounge room was nice, big and comfortable, but it was rarely used. When it wouldn't matter if there was just one or two of us or the whole crew was at home, the place we wanted to congregate in was the kitchen. It could have been because the fridge was close. It could have been because of the pantry was close. But I think it was because Mum was close. She was always in the kitchen. I'd like to share a few little memories that the boys and Lynn gave me to tell. And I'll start off with one that Lynn remembered. And that was that the day that Dad was teaching Mum to drive. Now, she learnt late in life. Lynn happened to be in the back seat of the car at the time, and they went up the main street with Dad trying to teach Mum how to drive. They get to the main street, and Dad was telling her how to reverse. Well, when the car stopped, Mum hurriedly got out of that car and sang out to him, "Well, you can drive the car yourself." Now, Lynn probably remembers that, and I'm only guessing, but I think she remembers that because Mum and Dad very rarely raised their voice. There was another time Lynn reminded me of, but I cannot remember it, the day that Mum chased us with wooden spoon in hand to get to Sunday school down the street. I don't think she caught us. Gary, he left home and joined the Navy, and he never came back to live in Coffs, so he's always away. And when he came home, it was quite an exciting time. Well, he remembers packing his family up in the car, driving all night and getting to Coffs early, very early in the morning, and Mum getting out of bed, and he remembers her making coffee for him. And then she'd go back to bed. Rob had a couple of mates, the O'Connor twins. And I think it was Neville. Neville was pretty comfortable at home. They came around and stayed quite a bit. And he'd go over to where Mum was cooking, lift the lid and say, "What's cooking?" And "What's for tea?" Mum would say, "Would you like to stay for tea?" And he said, "Oh, I suppose so." Rob also remembered the time where Mum said, well, he had a little pedal cart, which was a prized little thing, I suppose, and she said, "Now, don't go leaving that pedal cart around at the neighbours, because they used to take it around there and ride around on the concrete." And so Mum said, "Don't go leaving that cart around there." So anyway, one of the neighbours' grandsons borrowed it, took it around there and left it there, and his mother came down the drive and ran over it. Rob probably got in trouble for that, I don't know. I was laying in bed the other night and I thought, now, I'll just have a think about what I'll say. And the first thing that jumped into my head was, as a little tyke, the house was only two bedrooms. The two bedrooms had a wall between them. And I used to sleep next to that wall. And in the middle of the night, as a little fella, if you had to go to the toilet, I'd sing out, "Mum, need to do a wee." And Mum would get up. And she'd stand on the front, on the back stairs while I went and watered the grass. Now, back in them days, there wasn't inside toilets. There was the old outhouse. And if you happened to have to go into that scary outhouse of a night, everything was all right. But guess who was guarding the door? Mum. There was one other little thing that I remember. We always had chooks at our place for eggs, and every now and then we'd have a chook for tea. Anyway, I vividly remember being in the laundry with Mum putting hot water over the chooks and her and I plucking the chooks and gutting the chooks. Those memories are probably memories that any family would have, perhaps not the chooks. With the name Freak, Mum was a Matheson before she was a freak. And I don't know, some people just have a bit of a hard time when you say your name's Freak. They don't like to say it back to you or whatever. Mum had a little thing that shortcutted everything. She would say, they'd say, "What's your surname?" She'd say, "Freak. Just the everyday garden variety freak." F-R-E-A-K. So I'd just like to let every grandchild and every great-grandchild that there's a little bit of an everyday garden variety freak living right here in you.
Thanks, Pete. He got away with words, hasn't he? Family, friends, can I ask you to please stand now as we come to the most difficult part of our service, as we say farewell to Phyllis. And now tenderly, lovingly and reverently, we commit the body of our dear friend Phyllis Ivy Renison to the purifying fire and ultimately to the earth from which all life begins and to which all life in the end returns. We are grateful for the life that's been lived and for all that Phyllis's life has meant to each and every one of us. May we highly resolve today that while we live, we will strive with all our might to make our living of real worth. And now in the consciousness of work well done and a life well lived, death in the deeper sense can have no sting. We now leave our dear friend in peace. With respect, we bid Phyllis farewell, and thinking of her, let us leave this place with a spirit of thankfulness and live with concern and affection for one another. And Phyllis, may you rest in peace. Amen. Would you please be seated just for one more moment? I'd like to close with a beautiful psalm. It's the 23rd psalm. We heard Ron speak about Hilton and Phyllis attending Church of Christ. And so I'd like to share with you this beautiful psalm. Just following this psalm, we're going to have one final song, Amazing Grace, and I'd like to give everyone the opportunity to come and say their own goodbye to Phyllis. You're welcome to come up and touch her casket and leave the chapel. And following that final song, we're going to make our way to the Caramba Hotel to have a drink for her and share some more memories, please. The 23rd psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I don't have to fear any evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I love those last few words. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And it's a wonderful promise for Phyllis and for all of us that she's together with family that have gone before in a wonderful home. We won't have to worry about a toilet outside, Pete. She'll have an inside toilet and a wonderful home made of gold, I believe, as well. A wonderful place. And so if you'd like to play that song now, Phil, and if anyone would like to come up and say your own goodbye, please do.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How great appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils and snares, we have already thus far, and grace will lead us home. When we've been here 10,000 years, bright shine.